My name's Steve Chen. Probably most well known for being one of the co-founders of YouTube and one of the probably the earliest employees of PayPal Inc. And a little known fact, I was also one of the earliest engineers at Facebook for about 3 months before. So that was kind of this in sandwich between PayPal and starting YouTube. I was working at Facebook, and so in 2005, when I was filing my taxes, I was filing taxes with both PayPal, Facebook, and YouTube on it. And I don't think anybody else can make that claim ever. I think for a while there, so I left YouTube in about 2009, 2010. And probably for the first 12 months there, was trying to figure out, because all throughout the 20s and even early 30s, it was just working on startups, and it was always the kind of, there's no difference between Monday, Wednesday, Saturday, Sunday, there's no difference between whatever, 9 a.m. and 3 a.m. in the morning. And so I've been doing that for over a decade, and I was always thinking throughout that decade, while I was having fun, there were all these other things, just starting to get into coffee and photography and headphones and just speakers and watching all these movies that came out throughout all that time that I never got a chance to watch. But after the first 12 months, I just realized that none of it is as fun as kind of the challenge, the excitement, the sort of just everything that motivates people to start companies. Nothing really compares to that. So got back into starting a company, and so that's what I'm doing now. I went back to Google Ventures, as an entrepreneur in residence for about 18 months and got the support from Google Ventures. And then just about a month and a half ago, in August of 2015, left Google Ventures because we were ready to start getting external funding and doing our own hiring. With the early days of YouTube started in sort of in that 2005 timeframe. I think that the idea, the domain name itself, we bought it on Valentine's Day, so February 14th, 2005. There was another co-founder, Chad Hurley. We were in Menlo Park, California. And if you can imagine, we searched for YouTube on Google and zero results came up, right? And so we went out, bought the domain name, youtube.com, and started talking about the site. The site itself, originally the idea was, it's a little embarrassing to talk about, but it was actually supposed to be kind of a dating site. It was supposed to be a dating site where instead of posting your personal pictures and your personal introduction, you would post a video, and that would just to aggregate everything together, a little introduction to yourself, but you would actually see this person and be able to interact with them. Which, you know, we started developing, all the back end was still more or less the same of what you see with YouTube today, being able to upload videos, being able to transcode videos, being able to embed these videos onto different sites out there, onto social networking sites. And the development of the site took about 3 months, and we launched it in May of 2005. And for the first week, it was a total flop. You know, we didn't get a single video uploaded that was within the category domain of what we thought the site was going to be. Nobody was introducing themselves as using the site as a video dating site. However, what we saw was that videos were being uploaded. And so within that first week, we quickly changed. Again, the back end of the site remained exactly the same. It was just changing, you know, instead of searching for male or female in the age, you would just search for whatever you wanted to search for in a video. And the look and feel of it was changed a bit, but it was a very quick 2-day effort to convert what was a sort of a dating video site into a general video site. And one of the things is I met Chad, the other co-founder, at PayPal. The first day I moved out here to California, he was the original designer of PayPal, and I was one of the first engineers. And we worked on a number of projects together at PayPal. And same thing, I think one of the ideas of startups, of successful startups, is this idea of pivoting from what you were originally starting to doing something else instead. And PayPal, you know, many people know what it is now. Many people use it as a P2P payment service or to business personal to business payment service. But when it first started, It was this Palm Pilot security application that, you know, one, it never really got off the ground as a security app, and two, these days, I don't know many people that still own, carry around Palm Pilots. But the valuable lesson there was just, if you take a look at what the users are doing, what the user feedback is, and if people aren't using it, taking that technology and maybe pivoting it towards something that the users will use. And we did that at PayPal when we took the security side of it and created a payment service on top of it. Same thing at YouTube. No, in the beginning, it was not. So in the relationship with MySpace started with just the ability for MySpace users to embed HTML onto their profile pages, and YouTube had an HTML snippet that you could copy and paste and put into your MySpace profile. After a while, it became more of a formal relationship because so many of their users were using YouTube. It became almost a marriage that if YouTube went down, so much of the content on MySpace would not be available to view. So we started actually formalizing that relationship when we became aware that so many of their users depended on our service. I think especially early on in a startup and a company when you have very limited internal resources, right? I think some of these partnerships, especially early on when you don't get a lot of these invites, a lot of people asking you to be a partner, you get easily excited by it. I do think that it's valuable to not be overly aggressive in accepting some of these partnerships. So early on at YouTube, sort of an example of this was we had a lot of people asking us for white labeling the product and just removing YouTube off the label, removing sort of any references to YouTube, and they just wanted us, and they were willing to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars for this. And at that time, that meant a lot for YouTube. But at the end of the day, we always still hinged on the fact that the brand name of YouTube was very important to the product. And it was difficult. I mean, the earlier the company, I think, the more resource-starved the company, the harder it is to make that decision. But I do think that it's very important to actually choose the right partnerships that actually will help the company in the long run rather than just something in the next few months or next few weeks. I think that there are even a few companies that wanted to put their own video player on YouTube. When I was there, we didn't allow it. I think now YouTube has accepted some of those deals, but I think it's a whole different world by this point. And some of these guys, I mean, they just, you know, it's like ABC or something, and they're just only one unique creator of this content. You either do it their way or you'll never get their content. I think it's important to approach the question of any kind of partnership or any kind of agreement is looking at it from their perspective, what they benefit from a deal in the making with you. And I think in the case of YouTube, it was always the same. We didn't provide the revenue share, really. We didn't do the sort of ads early on, at least when we were there prior to the acquisition by Google. So when we did these deals, it was always for marketing purposes. It was always, yeah, so prior to the acquisition of Google, there was still no sort of, there was not a lot of ads coming in, so there was not a lot of ad revenue, so there was not a lot of the sort of revenue share that you see on YouTube. So what can we actually offer the content creators out there? It was really still for, at that time, it was really still for short length content. So things are, you know, 30 seconds to 2.5 minutes. It wasn't for long length. In fact, we had a rule that no content could be longer than 10 minutes for the large chunk of the start of YouTube. And so it was for a short length content. So it wasn't for, you wouldn't upload an entire 30-minute episode of The Daily Show or something. You wouldn't upload an entire 2-hour movie. One, we didn't allow it. And two, we didn't want the platform to be seen as that. It was still for short pieces of content that was uploaded to the site. So when it came to actually working with these content creators, we branded YouTube as a way to be able to market your longer form content. So it was just maybe seen as a place, a platform to show movie trailers for your movie, but you wouldn't actually upload the entire movie onto YouTube. I think that's gradually evolved and changed over a period of time as higher quality content has become possible. Bandwidth has started getting cheaper. People are more accustomed to watching this content on multiple devices now that YouTube actually offers and caters to watching the same content on multiple devices at one time. But at the time, during 2005 all the way throughout 2007, it was always sort of short form content. It wasn't the same quality, and it was a way to be able to get more people that would have not heard your music or would have not heard your movie be able to use the 2-minute length to be able to showcase whatever it is that you wanted to show.